So good evening, and thanks to the committee for this outstanding opportunity. I would like to say, first of all, thanks to all you here interested in uncontrolled donation and also in ECPR options through ECMO. But obviously, I want to say especially thanks to Dr. Mateusz Pruzlecki and all the rest of people working here at the hospital and linked to the SIM Center. It has been for me really a very interesting opportunity to share with you all this joint venture on ECMO. So ECPR for saving lives first after cardiac arrest, but also not disregarding the option of increasing the organ donation pool through disease donation. I have to say that I do not have any conflict of interest to declare, but during my daily practice of uncontrolled donation after circulatory determination of death in my helicopter emergency medical service at Madrid, I really had many conflicts, some of them probably of interest or interesting for you all. And that's why probably I'm here. So let's start. I need a minute to put you in context and to be sure that we are at the same page with the glossary or terms, and also with the ideas that ECMO enables us. Firstly, uncontrolled donation happens when the emergency medical service responding to a sudden cardiac out of hospital decide the termination of resuscitation on the field. However, controlled donation happens after deciding the withdrawal of life support techniques in the environment, in the framework of a critical care unit at the hospital. Secondly, it's also important to understand that although according to Spanish law and regulations, the consent for organ donation is presumed, in real practice, we ever ask for permission to families to proceed with organ donation. So opt-out system, in theoretically speaking, but in practice, is a soft opt-out system because family has the final veto. Therefore, the consent is always required and is a must from the National Transplant Organization in order to maintain the truthfulness and trust in the system by the whole society. Well, my talk will follow these topics and these points. First, what are uncontrolled DCD protocols? Why these protocols, control and uncontrolled DCD, were born? Its potential, that it's very big, but also its concerns and issues. Then why I state that organ donation and resuscitation strategies are currently twisted, tangled, and the proposal that we do to untangle both strategies. So, a manner to mitigate the current issues that exist. And finally, in my humble opinion, just some take-home messages and conclusions. So in disease donation after circulatory death, the clinical pathways are quite clear. You have the different pathways depending on the kind of protocols, control and uncontrolled. I will focus today on uncontrolled DCD pathway. I know that it's still not widespread in Poland and is summarized in this slide in the right part of the picture. As you are going to see immediately in a video, it's a fast-paced rhythm, necessary, mandatory, obligatory to reach the end goal of increasing the organ donation pool. To make possible, it's a so fast-paced rhythm that sometimes it's very demanding for us, health providers, but mostly for families. Spain was the leading country paving the way of uncontrolled donation. I mean to mitigate the scarcity of organs for transplants. And what is exactly uncontrolled donation and how the process is? Well, the process begins following a sudden cardiac arrest out of the hospital. And when resuscitation fails, interventions like ongoing chest compressions and ventilation during transport to the hospital are already trying to preserve the organs on an individual that is considered not a patient, but a potential donor. So the individual is managed as a potential organ donor, so far is not a patient because it's a hopeless patient after failed CPR. The diagnosis of death occurs after arrival to the hospital. There is a no-touch period of 5 minutes, and then patient is cannulated, but not patient, the individual, in order to restart the perfusion to the brain and heart and the other organs in order to obtain the organs for transplantation. Problem is that as ECMO in this moment enables to reflow the brain, we need to block the descending aorta with a Fogarty catheter. So consent requirements for organ preservation and procurement occur after declaring death and at the hospital approaching the family. Never before, never on the scene and on the street or at home. I want to share with you a short video explaining all this process. I have added some footnotes in English explaining each step from out-of-hospital cardiac arrest scenario to organ procurement at the hospital, and particularly the procedure for organ preservation of kidneys and lungs. So now the ambulance is sent to the scenario with the main coordinator that is just assuring that high quality advanced life support is delivered by emergency physicians on site, nurses and paramedics. All the ambulance in my country are in the advanced life support level staffed by all these professionals, so doctors, nurses and paramedics. And an extra team is delivering these cases in order to enable the privacy to working on the scene in a protected tent. Therefore, at that moment, the decision is to start organ preservation with mechanical chest compressors and ventilation in order to reach a specific hospital in which a pre-alert transplant coordinator is waiting for the incoming individual, not patient. Then they hand over the pre-hospital team with the people in the emergency room, but here in the room on the back is the transplant coordinator waiting for the decision to do a no-touch period of 5 minutes. And the certificate, the diagnosis of death is done here. And after a no-touch period of 5 minutes, they go to the block that it's already prepared for ECMO with the proposal to preserve the organs, not to save the patient. So it's not deliver ECPR, but ASOR, extracorporeal interval support until organ retrieval. Blood samples are taken at this point, and this transplant coordinator is organizing the transfer to the block in which the ECMO machine for ASOR, never for ECPR, is already prepared in order to proceed with cannulation, Fogarty balloon, in order to avoid the reperfusion to brain and heart, and then ASOR start with the warm ischemic time limit of 4-6 hours, so normothermic ECMO, in order to be sure that kidneys will be useful for transplanting a potential recipient. They are doing now a simulation of the system that you all know perfectly, explaining the parts of the machine that obviously you know, but I put this video mostly thinking in the next seconds in which you will see a procedure that is not so common and is the preservation of lungs after instituting a cooling liquid in order to collapse the lungs with Perfadex at 4 degrees, and during several hours are perfused with this solution and therefore are extracted in order to be transplanted to a potential recipient in the waiting list. So this part is more for kidneys. And later on, you will see the procedure that it's less common, at least in number of organs obtained for lungs. To be fair, this video was recorded 12 years ago, and now obviously the devices have changed. So we use other devices as you do, but the Fogarty, it's quite interesting in the sense that it's not common to see this. It's the contralateral groin in order to inflate a balloon and to isolate the organs that we want to reperfuse and to avoid reperfusion to brain and heart because it's an already declared disease person. And that's the part in which I want to stress a bit because of the lungs procedure, it's a bit different. It's a solution that was imported from Norwegian and Denmark researchers. And so far the results, the outcomes with 4 degree temperature cooling system have been resulting very good outcomes. So they put 4 intercostal drains and they collapse the lungs as you are going to see in the diagram. So it's the way to preserve these lungs. And during this procedure, the consent is obtained from family. So the approach to families is done when the already declared deceased person is already cannulated on the block. So Yes, one part we have good news. These programs increase organ donation rates, it's clear, by making donors some of those individuals who could not be resuscitated from cardiac arrest. But we have also raising questions, ethical issues. Ethical concerns, for example, derive from the possibility that organ preservation could compromise treatment for some patients in refractory cardiac arrest. In our systematic review of uncontrolled donation programs, we identified these concerns. First, what about transparency and truthfulness of information delivered to the family on the scene, on the street, at home? What about organ preservation initiated during ambulance transport? Because we are going to a specific center in which a pre-alert transplantation team is waiting for us, but it's not an incoming patient. It's an incoming individual in which we have decided to finish CPR efforts. So what about also consent for cannulation for the deceased? Because he's asked for it when it's already cannulated and connected to the ECMO machine for organ preservation goal. What about the objective, the goal of inserting an intra-aortic balloon to avoid reperfusion of brain and heart after declaring death? And finally, the most important issue for me today, what about the role of extracorporeal technique for organ preservation versus life-saving goal? So many questions, probably of interest for a Q&A period lately, but today, again, I'm focusing on this last question, this last issue. Is CPR versus or ASOR? But I would also, I would like to depict shortly the concerns derived from controlled donation after circulatory death. This clinical pathway, as said previously, is different. These programs have the potential to increase, again, organ donation rates by making donors some of those individuals who suffer a catastrophic brain injury and who are in the ICU or critical care units. When we decide that we are going to withdraw life support techniques, because the patient is not in situation of neurologic or brain death. But controlled DCD raises also a number of ethical issues, clinical issues, all them derived from the possibility that organ donation could compromise caring for some patients in end-of-life state. In controlled DCD programs, these are the burning questions that we identified. What about transparency again and truthfulness when approaching families at the ICU for the withdrawal of life support technique decision? What about quantity and quality of organs that we obtain finally, so cost effectiveness of this, because obviously the organs are not same quality than in neurologic death. What about the info delivered to the family? It's complete, it's truthful. What we explain to the families when their love is sent to the operating room in order to accomplish with the time limit, 90 minutes, in which the heart must be stopped after extubation. Because the reality is 40% of situation, the cardiac arrest doesn't happen in this time limit. And obviously, the surgery team disagree with extracting kidneys or liver or lungs probably in this situation. And when the already hopeless patient come back to the ICU, which quality of end-of-life state caring are we giving to them? Because family said goodbye in the ICU after saying yes for donation, and 40% of times come back. So it's a second breaking bad news in a very short time gap. And what about the ICU nurses expecting not to have a patient because he's supposed to be an organ donor? So in their mind, caring has finished, and a couple of hours, 3 hours later, the potential donor is coming back as a patient in a situation that it's called in an uncertain manner, because we are expecting for he or she dying as soon as possible. Well, what about, again, the problem of extracorporeal matching in this scenario also? Because if we restart perfusion to brain and heart, we are retrospecting the already declared death of a patient and what happened at this point also. But coming back to uncontrolled donation, obviously we can summarize saying that on the one hand, there is an international scarcity of organs. That's completely real. On the other hand, there is a very high incident at international level of out-of-hospital cardiac arrest with a poor survival outcomes. I have new the outcomes, for example, for Poznan this morning are very similar to Madrid ones. 1,100 cardiac arrest in the pre-hospital setting each year, and less than 10% of them with a good survival with quality of life. So we have a big potential of organ donation pool, but we have a very dramatic and poor results from out of hospital cardiac arrest in terms of survival with quality of life. Therefore, two potential strategies to implement. What we do with funds, with money, with efforts? Do we widespread the uncontrolled DCD in order to increase the organ donation pool? Or do we increase the quality of CPR in the streets and at home in order to save a few more patients than today? ECMO enables both strategies. The problem is when situation is implemented in a manner that it's fighting the one against the other. Well, the extracorporeal technique and the possibilities are different. ECMO is useful in uncontrolled DCD process because enables to preserve the organs of an already declared death individual. ECMO procures oxygen to the organs, and the device pumps blood inside the body of a deceased, avoiding the ischemia progress. The ethical issues arise because when running ECMO in organ preservation, the machine restores circulation, and to avoid the oxygenated blood to reach brain and heart, the aorta is blocked with this balloon, this Fogarty catheter. By this way, is prevented to restore life to the already deceased individual. So that, where is the thin red line between life and death? Is this line blurry, shadowy, vague? But ECMO, at the same time, The same described technique is also useful during CPR to save the life of select patients. To be clear, very select patients in cardiac arrest. Then the name is ECPR, extracorporeal resuscitation, and the same device with the same people working around it is connected as soon as possible by the same manner to a still patient. Restoring circulation to the brain, first goal, and obviously to the other organs. Maintaining all the other organs perfused, but heart and lung functions are replaced by the machine. And medic team, during this while, can identify, can repair, or can treat the underlying primary cause of cardiac arrest when reversible. That's the case of SAMU de Paris, in which they decide to do this in the streets. So to give the possibility of ECPR for selected patients on the streets or at home. The question is, probably, is it feasible? Because they did it, but is possible to extrapolate these results? How many time they need of learning curve speaking for arriving to these results? Can we duplicate the same? Is cost effective positive? I'm going to show you just the first couple of minutes of the video in the TV France shooting, and then you will see that they are going to put the ECMO in a supermarket, in the half marathon run in Paris last year, at home, in selected patients, obviously with different results in one case or the other. So this is the team delivered at the scene. They are deciding to stop termination of resuscitation in ALS algorithm, but however, approaching the machine to the patient that it's previously selected. This is the case of a 27-year-old male arriving at the meta of the last marathon in Paris, and he survived after implementing the ECMO machine in the street. But this other case that you are seeing, in which the decision to stop CPR and to win the ECMO was different, and the patient finally died. The question is, okay, is it feasible, but is it possible to duplicate this experience? Because other option, very different, is this one, to do the same attitude. In this case is a colleague from US, but on arrival of an incoming patient to the emergency room or the cath lab. And in this case, they are performing what you perfectly know, and it's the experience that, for example, is trying to expand in several centers. My good colleague Jean Belolabek, who is sharing the results of the first RCT ALS algorithm versus ECPR algorithm in Prague in Czech Republic. So this possibility after arrival at the hospital seems to be probably more cost effective because it's not needed to go to look for the patient with a team that probably is not doing all the days this kind of cannulation and in a most safety environment. Please observe now these short videos of my work in Madrid. And it's in the helicopter emergency medical service, and I want to ask you something. Would you be able to know if the medical crew is performing ongoing CPR, so trying to save the life of a patient, or transporting a deceased donor eligible for uncontrolled donation, so trying to save the organs? of an already considered hopeless patient? Let me tell you the answer. One of them is enroll as a potential disease donor. The other is still treated as a potential patient for ECPR and is under ongoing CPR to the hospital. So only the end goal of both scenarios is different, but we are doing pretty the same during pre-hospital setting phase. Does it matter? Yes, it does. It does. Because Madrid Emergency Medical Service portfolio includes the leading uncontrolled DCD worldwide, the most powerful. I realize when approaching out-of-hospital cardiac arrest patients that resuscitation and organ preservation strategies were implemented so far, in a manner that generates conflicts of interest. There is a kind of tug of war game between organ donation and resuscitation. One side, we have the patient interests. In the other, we have the interest and expectation of potential recipients in the wait list. Next statement is, albeit exceptional, it's also exceptionally troubling. Some uncontrolled DCD donors, in which organ preservation was initiated after considering failed CPR, some of them have had return of spontaneous circulation. And some of them have had a full neurologic recovery. This slide tried to share with you how means, resources, technical and human resources, necessary for running both strategies are exactly the same. Only the end goal is different, to save the organs in uncontrolled donation by reducing the ischemia time versus to save the brain, so the life with quality of life of the patient, reducing the ischemia to the brain after a refractory cardiac arrest, ECPR. I want to point out that today, while speaking with you here in Spain, we have 12 running uncontrolled DCD programs widespread in my country. Not a single one of ECPR, 4 out of hospital refractory cardiac arrest. We have some of them for in-hospital cardiac arrest. So people working in the pre-hospital setting, we have many conflicts of interest. And currently, twisted strategies should be untangled in order to clarify where the priorities are. This burning question provoked recently a special issue of the most famous report, the Hastings Center report on ethical issues in the world. The main bioethicists were involved. And it's really astonishing and troubling to evidence this fact that means, resources, and procedures for both ECPR and ASOR, so ECMO for organ preservation, are once again the same. So Poland, we have a problem, but Poland, we have a solution also. Uncontrolled DCD can mitigate organ shortage, that's clear, but its implementation should be done, must be done very carefully. And we can do it. Our proposal, published in The Lancet, is a synergetic strategy. This synergetic strategy is to save more lives one way or another. On the upper arm of the picture, you will see what is still happening today in Spain. In the timeline, patient end goal is one quarter. Three quarters of the strategy is focused on obtaining a potential donor. Why not to do the proposal below? First, high quality ongoing CPR until arrival to a center in which a perfect team with a learning curve using eCPR do a new triage in order to be sure that this specific patient benefits from eCPR, selecting the patient, saving more lives than before, because we reduce the low flow time, arriving as soon as possible under ongoing CPR to a center in which medic team is already prepared with the prime machine, with the eCPR technique, and with the learning curve. And if, despite of doing all this, the patient finally, it's not possible to save him or her, we have still the possibility under ECMO to change from eCPR to ASOR. And we will approach family in this place, not hiding information on the scene, not saying clearly what we are doing and which center are we going, which machine for organ preservation is waiting for us with a transplant coordinator. No. Priorities are clear. We save more patients, previously hopeless patients, obviously selected patients. And finally, if it's not possible, despite of doing our best, the option of disease donation, clearly explain it to the love, is possible, is still possible. So we propose a comprehensive approach to the cardiac arrest, which makes compatible both strategies, resuscitation and or donation, a joint venture. As you probably know, some steps in this sense have been already done here in Great Poland with the protocol that it's in the way of being implemented little by the team that you have as teacher and colleagues. That's for me an extraordinary and pioneering protocol that you have to push for sure, because it's a manner to do it things in the right way. Because by this way, we would be able to save more patients from cardiac arrest first, and if not indicated or futile from the beginning, we could increase the organ donation pool when confirming the irreversibility of cardiac arrest after declaring death. Jan Belolavec, a Czech Republic, recently released these results from the so-called hyperinvasive approach to refractory cardiac arrest in Prague. Can you see the encouraging results after randomizing close to 300 patients in both arms? Excellent. Is statistically significant? Probably not yet, not enough. It's also necessary to know that it has been enrolling patients for 12 years. So the learning curve changed during the process, but obviously encouraging results. And one result that was very interesting, and I was talking about this morning with the emergency medical service here in Poznan, is that because of doing this, the standard arm doubled the survival. Before to implement this randomized control trial, the survival with quality of life at Prague were not this one you say here, 22, but 11%. And just to have in the brain of emergency medical service personnel the idea to do correctly things with the chain of survival well implemented, double also the survival in the standard arm of the protocol. That's excellent, because the average of population in Prague increased their survival after cardiac arrest, and that was because the randomized control trial trying to demonstrate the utility of eCPR in select patients. So this result is probably most important than the final one, that it's also important. 39% of survival CPC 1 or 2 after hyperinvasive approach, so after eCPR. Well, I'm finishing. This is New Zealand colleagues doing things from the pre-hospital with a simulation phase with mannequins and doing the handover of simulated mannequin with the pre-cannulation phase, with the cannulation phase, and with the briefing and debriefing between the personnel from the emergency medical service and the people from the emergency room and the cath lab and cardiologists. Obviously, you know perfectly what is necessary to do step by step, because you are doing it very robustly with a very good quality of rationale in your country and in your city and in your region. And you must be proud, because I'm proud of you when seeing what you are doing and what you are able to do in the next future. Just a couple of open questions to the audience here. Is there coherence and trust in disease donation in the manner it's implemented so far, and controlled donation? The message you are sending to the family, to the society, to the health providers is coherent and is truthful with the reality that we are showing to them? Second question, are we all, so health providers, professionals, society as a whole, at the same page when talking about organ donation, or not yet? And why not? So these are my conclusions. In the current practice of most uncontrolled DCD programs, it is unclear whether potentially recoverable patients are given all therapeutics options, whether the protocol itself reduces patients' chance of survival in some cases, and whether all uncontrolled DCD donors are dead. Second, we have depicted here the aspects of uncontrolled DCD which need improvement as a result of the scientific evidence in the management of cardiac arrest before giving up resuscitation. Although we are supporters, I'm a supporter of disease donation in particular and organ donation in general, I state that not all the ways should be considered acceptable for increasing donor pool. The issues identified here, I think, are significant enough to call for a comprehensive review of uncontrolled DCD. Transplant policymakers should care not only about what they are trying to do, but about how to get there. And we can do it better than we are doing so far. You are doing it. And in my humble opinion, if I can be helpful for doing as you want to do, I'm here for this. So, dziękuję.